Hello and welcome to our Family Connect Easter special. I am Michelle, the Children and Youth Ministry Coordinator at Canterbury Baptist Church, and I'm delighted that you have joined us this afternoon as we find out all about Easter and learn a truly excellent story. I promise there will probably be more Easter and egg puns along the way, but you know, I can't help having a bit of a yoke. I mean a joke. If you've got any Easter jokes, you might want to share them in the chat below, especially if you're watching this on Facebook Live, you can chat in the comments below. Now we're going to explore this afternoon what Easter is and why at Canterbury Baptist Church Easter is so special and so important to us and why it's a time of celebration. And we're going to start by thinking about Palm Sunday. Now, Palm Sunday is the day that Jesus rode into Jerusalem on the donkey. And we're going to start with a game. So Andrew and Hope and Ruby are going to play a game with us. And then we're going to go into a song. Now, you may have made your palm leaf out of your gift bag like this with your hands. And maybe while we sing our song, you want to wave your palm to worship Jesus and join in. So let's start with a game, and I hope that you enjoy this afternoon.
Hello, girls. Happy Easter.
Yeah, happy Easter again.
To celebrate Palm Sunday, we're going to play a special game now. Hope, if you could just move so everyone could see the picture. We're going to play a special game called Pin the Cloak on the Donkey. Do you know why we might be playing Pin the Cloak on the Donkey instead of Pin the Tail on the Donkey? Yes, Hope.
Because of Palm Sunday.
Because of Palm Sunday, yes. Because followers of Jesus laid their cloaks on the road and on the donkey as he rode into Jerusalem. So we're going to pin our cloaks on the donkey. And to make it a little bit more difficult, you're going to have a blindfold on, aren't you, Ruby? Show everyone at home what the blindfold looks like. There it is.
My blindfold.
And we're going to spin you round two times as well. Yeah.
I'm going to be so
right.
Dizzy.
That's going to be easy because I don't even care about dizziness.
So, first of all, Hope is going to have her turn. Come on, Hope.
No, I'm
going
to go first.
I'll take the rainbow.
No.
I want to
go first.
Okay, you can go first.
Yeah. Ruby's going to go first.
Whatever.
Now, Ruby, come here. Mm-hmm. And we're going to spin you round three times. Hope, would you spin Ruby round three times? Two, three, and make sure she's facing the right direction now. Okay, Ruby, you move forward, and pin the cloak on the donkey. Have a look. Oh, wow, what a good job. Look at that. That's going to be hard to beat, Hope.
Oh, come on.
Maybe you could play this game at home with your own children, with your own brothers and sisters, or even with your adult friends. Hope, it's your turn to pin the cloak on the donkey. Okay, Ruby, we're going to put the blindfold on Hope.
And I can spin her around.
Yep. Okay. Hope's got the blindfold on. Ruby's going to spin around three times. One, two, three. Slightly aggressive. And point her in the right direction. Here she goes. Hope is going to pin the cloak.
Is that why it's Hope?
It's on the donkey. Let's see. Wow, great job. Girls, you both pinned your cloaks in the same place, which means you're both winners. Yay. Congratulations. Thanks very much, girls.
Up and down, gonna spin right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna shout out loud, gonna deafen the crowd, gonna send my praise to heaven. I'm gonna jump up and down, gonna spin right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna shout out loud, gonna deafen the crowd, gonna send my praise to heaven. Run this race and I will never stop. Gonna follow Jesus to the day I drop. Gonna do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When you got such a law, when you got not a law, what? Be happy. Gonna jump up and down, gonna spin right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna shout out loud, gonna deafen the crowd, gonna send my praise to heaven. Gonna jump up and down, gonna spin right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna shout out loud, gonna deafen the crowd, gonna send my praise to heaven. Gonna run this race and I will never stop. Gonna follow Jesus till the day I drop. Gonna do all things through Christ who strengthens me. When you got such a law, when you got not a law, what? Be happy. Jump up and down, gonna sing right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna shout out loud, gonna deafen the crowd, gonna send my praise to heaven. I'm gonna jump up and down, gonna spin right around, gonna praise your name forever. I'm gonna shout out loud, gonna deafen the crowd, gonna send my praise to heaven.
I hope you enjoyed waving your palm and dancing along to that song. Thank you, Adam, for providing us with a fantastic start to this afternoon. Now, do you like eggs? I love eggs. There's so much that you can do with eggs, so much you can do with them. You can have fried eggs, you can have scrambled eggs. When you're poorly, maybe I like to have dippy eggs with soldiers, soft-boiled eggs. And over lockdown, I finally mastered how to make poached eggs. And even with eggs, you can mix them up with flour and sugar and make a cake. Now at Easter, the eggs we talk about the most are chocolate eggs. And some are solid chocolate, some are hollow, and some have a yummy filling inside. I wonder what your favourite Easter egg is. Maybe you might want to tell us down below. Now today, I'm going to tell you a story using eggs to help me. Now you have the whole of this story inside the plastic egg that came in your gift bag. You may have already looked at it and thought it was a bit strange, some of those things inside that egg, if you've collected one. But how cool is that? You've got the whole of a story in that egg. If you don't have the gift bag, don't worry. You're still welcome to follow along and find out about this story. Now this story happened a long time ago to a man called Jesus. And I believe that this story is true, and I can't wait to share it with you today. I really believe that it's a truly excellent story. Now, Jesus was a special teacher who told people about God and his kingdom, and he taught us how to live. And this story is all about Jesus. So let's see what's in my egg box. So I'm going to take, my eggs are numbered, they're slightly different. I'm going to take egg number one. And when Jesus was about 33 years old, a little bit younger than me, he rode a donkey into a city called Jerusalem. And the people were pleased to see him, and they waved palm branches and they shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Now inside your egg you have a small piece of palm. Well, you could find a branch or make one, the one using the instructions. To welcome Jesus into your home. Now Jesus entered the city of Jerusalem as a king. People welcomed him as a king. But kings don't ride on donkeys. Kings ride on horses and probably walk along a nice carpet. Not a carpet made of people's cloaks and robes that they laid on the floor. And the crowds worshipped him and they praised him and they were so pleased to see him. However, I'm going to tell you how that all changed in this story today. So a couple of days later, Jesus was having dinner with some friends and a woman came in and poured a whole jar of perfume over Jesus. In your egg number two, in your egg, you may find a small piece of cotton wool. And if you smell that cotton wool, you might be able to smell perfume. Can you smell it? Imagine the smell that would have filled the perfume that evening when this woman did this. I've got a whole jar of perfume here and it smells quite strong. If I spray it, it's quite a strong smell. Ooh. Can you imagine a whole jar of that was poured all over your head? That's what this woman did for Jesus. Jesus's friends, his disciples, thought the woman had wasted the perfume because it wasn't cheap perfume. It was very expensive perfume. It would have cost her a year's wages. She would have had to work for a whole year, probably more, to be able to afford to buy that jar of perfume. And Jesus told his friends and the disciples that the reason the woman poured this perfume over his head was to prepare him for burial, for when he died. But what do you think Jesus' friends would have thought when he said this, when he would have poured the perfume to prepare him for burial? Because they weren't imagining that he would die very soon. Now, we're going to move on a couple of days later, and on the Thursday of the same week, Jesus was about to have a special meal with his friends. As they were preparing to eat, Jesus wrapped a towel around his waist and poured water into a basin. He then started to wash the disciples' feet. Now, these feet would have been in sandals. They would have been sweaty, smelly and dirty. Think about how your feet might smell after a day at school or a day playing football. They probably are a bit stinky and a bit sweaty. And this was normally a job that servants would do, to wash the feet, not the teacher, not somebody who they thought they worshipped as a king or somebody who they thought was sent from God. Now, in your egg, you have a small piece of towel that looks like this. And you might get this towel wet and think about how you would feel if somebody important was to wash your feet. How would you feel if you were at lunchtime at school and your teacher came up and started washing your feet in the middle of your lunch? It would be a bit odd. You would be a bit confused. And then later on that evening, as they were eating, Jesus took the bread that they were eating and he broke it. And he said, "Take this and eat it, for it's my body which is broken for you." And he then took the cup of wine that they also were drinking. And he said, "Drink this. This is my blood that's poured out for you, for the forgiveness of sins." And the disciples didn't know then. They probably thought this was a bit strange as well. But Jesus was telling them of what was to come. Now, after Jesus had finished this special meal, he went out to pray in a place called the Mount of Olives. And Jesus knew what was about to happen to him because he was God's son. I believe that Jesus was God's son. And he knew what was going to happen and why it was going to happen. But he still asked his Father God if there was another way. He said, "Not my will, but your will be done." But what does that mean? Jesus was saying to God, "Not what I want to happen, but what you plan to happen, to be done." He knew exactly what was ahead, but he still turned to God for help and strength. Now, in egg number 4, let's see what we've got. We've got a small scroll like this. And on that scroll, you might want to open your scroll. And it is a blank piece of paper at the moment. But on this piece of paper, you might want to pray and write a prayer to ask God to help you in difficult times. If we trust God, we have to believe it's not what we want, but what God wants that we place our trust in. Remember, no matter what happens, God hears you and God is always with you. So Jesus knew that one of his disciples was going to betray him. And betray is a big word that is a bit difficult to understand, but it means breaking the trust and faith of others who trust you. Even though Jesus knew this was going to happen, he didn't stop it because it was all part of God's plan. Now, in your egg, you might find, I wonder what's in here. You might find a silver coin. Now, I've got lots of silver coins in my egg to remind me of the next part of the story. And one of Jesus' disciples, called Judas, was paid 30 silver coins by the Romans to tell them where to find Jesus and arrest him, because they believed that these things he was saying and the things people were saying about him, that he was the king of the Jews, was not true. Now I want you to hold that silver coin in your hand and think about the cost, the price that Judas was paid to betray his friend. And have you ever been asked to do something that you knew wasn't right? How did you respond in that situation? What did you do? I know I've been asked to do things that I know haven't been right. And sometimes I've done it even though I know it's not been right, because I thought that was the best thing to do at the time. And sometimes I've said, no, I know that's not right, I'm not going to do it. But that's hard. And I wonder how you would respond in that situation. And following Jesus comes at a cost. We don't have to pay money to follow him, no. But Jesus paid the ultimate price for us, and we'll come to that soon. But following Jesus means that we have to give him everything. We have to give Jesus our whole lives. So Judas told the Roman guards where they could find Jesus to arrest him. Judas said that the one he kissed on the cheek was the one who they were to arrest. So Judas went up to Jesus in the garden and went to kiss him on the cheek. Jesus knew what was about to happen, and the Roman guard stepped forward and arrested him. He didn't run away, he didn't hide, but he let them arrest him because he knew that this was part of God's bigger plan. And that's quite sad in this story, but I also know and believe that that was part of God's bigger plan. Now, we are on egg number 6, or the 6th item in your egg. And inside this egg is a piece of string, a length of string. And this string is meant to represent or make you think about the ropes and the whips that we used to beat Jesus. Jesus was arrested, and then the guards made fun of Jesus, and they were beating him with ropes and whips. They blindfolded him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell us who hit you." They were being really unkind. Now, if you clap your hands really hard, can you do that? 1, 2, 3. That's a bit better. That first one wasn't very good. You might be able to imagine the sound of a whip. Now, think about how it would have been felt to have been beaten by these whips and ropes. Clapping my hands that hard really hurt my hands. But can you imagine if you were being beaten by whips and ropes? And Jesus went through all of this. Jesus felt all this pain of being beaten, but he didn't fight against it. He took that pain from those mean guards. Another excellent thing to do at Easter is to have an Easter egg hunt. So you'll be hopping mad not to. Now, Hope, Ruby and Anna are going to have an Easter egg hunt to find out what our memory verse is for today. I wonder if you can work it out alongside Hope. Another excellent thing to do at Easter is to have an Easter egg hunt. So you'll be hopping mad not to. Now, Hope, Ruby and Anna are going to have an Easter egg hunt to find out what our memory verse is for today. I wonder if you can work it out alongside Hope.
So our memory verse game today is an Easter egg hunt. Are we ready, girls?
Yeah.
We've got 7 eggs to find, and within those 7 eggs is another part of our memory verse. What we're going to do, girls, is find those 7 eggs, bring them to the table beside me here, and then we're going to sort them out into the right order. Okay? So everyone at home, let's count them down with 3, 2, 1, go! Go on then, Anna, you go and find them as well. Good girl. Let's see how they get on here. So within the little eggs, I think there's a little Easter egg, and there are different parts of our memory verse to today. So if you're going to have an Easter egg hunt, why don't you consider doing something similar as this? And whilst the girls are playing the game, you might want to guess what our memory verse is and even put them into the right order for us. Well done, Ruby. Come and put them on the table beside me here. Well done, Rubes. Do you want to open them up, Ruby?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
There is chocolate.
I found another one.
Well done. So let's open up all of the eggs, girls.
These are mine. So this one.
And those of you watching at home, you can try and work out what our memory verse is for today. Okay. So, Ruby, what have we got?
I don't know to read, but I'm gonna have these chocolates.
That's okay, you can read a little bit, can't you?
I may have.
So let's use the table to put them in. So we've got John 10:10. We've got have it. We have to the full.
I've got two eggs. And
they may have.
And I have. I'm going to eat them.
And what's this one, Hope? Came that. Okay, so Hope, do you want to try and put those in the right order for us? Everyone at home, you might want to try and have a guess what you think it might be. That was a good idea, Hope, putting them in the gaps on the table.
This is the end.
So you think John 10:10 goes at the end? Yep.
I'm going to eat my eggs. I guess some to Hope.
Okay, Ruby.
I guess some to Anna. Because Anna only got one.
Okay, you eat your eggs.
No, I only got two.
It's alright, you're doing a good job.
I only got two.
So what do you think will go first?
I don't really know.
You're probably looking for a capital letter, I reckon.
Yes.
So can you see a capital letter anywhere?
That's not it, no.
Could be, couldn't it?
This one maybe.
Let's go with I have as the beginning, shall we, everyone?
I have.
Yummy chocolate.
You're enjoying your chocolate, Anna?
I have. They may have.
Not yet.
They may have.
Okay, I have.
Life.
I need to get my egg.
I think you might need one of these ones. I have to the full. No. I have come that. That
I
might work.
Life.
I have come that.
Life.
I can't sit down.
What do you think might be next, everyone? I have come that.
I'm not going to read this then.
What's this one say? They may have. That seems to make sense.
I think it's going to be life.
I have come that they may have.
I think it's that.
Could you put that on the table for me? They may have.
I have life, and they may.
I have come that they may have
life.
And
have it.
And have it
to the full.
And have it to the full. John chapter 10, verse 10. What do you think, everyone? Do you think that might be right?
Yeah.
I think that may well be right. I think at home you're seeing this back to front, but never mind. This says, I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. John 10, verse 10. Hey, well done, everyone. Congratulations. Good job. Hope that you enjoy your own Easter eggs and perhaps your own Easter egg hunt at home this Easter.
Share your chocolate with
your
parents.
Share your chocolate with the parents.
Did you figure out what it was? This was something that Jesus said, and it says, I came to give you life and give it to the full. And that's in John 10, verse 10. So we're now on egg number 7, or the 7th thing in your Easter egg. And Jesus was then taken before the high priests and the people who made the laws and put on trial. And a trial is something that usually happens when someone has done something wrong and we need to find out if they are guilty. That means they've done the crime. And people said lots of untrue things about Jesus and he stayed silent when they questioned them. Now I wonder, what do you do if people say untrue things about you? Do you stay silent or do you argue back? Now, some of you might know me, and I must admit that I'm not very good at staying silent. And if people are saying things about me or saying things that I don't believe are true, I probably would argue back. Maybe that's something I need to work on. But Jesus stayed silent. The only time Jesus responded was when the high priests asked Jesus if he was the Son of God. And Jesus replied with, "You have said so." And the high priest then said, "He's spoken against God. Do we need any more?" And the other priest said, "He should die for what he has done." But in those days, to sentence somebody to death, the Jewish leaders had to have the Roman governor's permission. So they took Jesus before the Roman governor, Pilate, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus replied with, "Well, those are your words." The priests and the chief elders then began to accuse him, and even still, Jesus did nothing to defend himself, much to the amazement of Pilate. And Pilate could find nothing wrong with him, so he eventually said to the crowds, "What shall I do with this man? What do you want me to do with Jesus, who is called King of the Jews?" And the crowd were really angry. They shouted back, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" And that means to kill him. So the soldiers took Jesus, stripped him of his clothes, and put a crown of thorns on his head. And in your egg is a very tiny crown. I've just dropped mine. Now, in your egg is a very tiny crown. But I've also got another crown here to help you think of the crown of thorns. And a crown is usually worn by a king or a queen, the most important person in the land. And the soldiers put this crown on his head to make fun of Jesus. And they were pretending to bow down to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews! Hail, King of the Jews! I wonder, can you do that? Hail, King of the Jews! Hail, King of the Jews!" But they weren't saying it in a nice way, like we might say something like that to the king or queen. They were being unkind. But this crown wasn't made of gold or metal, it was made of thorns. And have you ever touched a thorn? I know that I have, and it really, really hurts. And in the summer, we bought a cactus for my brother, and I accidentally touched one of the thorns, and it got stuck in my finger. And it was so painful. It took so long for me to be able to get that thorn out of my finger. And that was just one tiny little thorn. So can you imagine how painful that crown would have felt on Jesus' head? The crown in your egg isn't a crown of thorns, but maybe you could think about how could you make Jesus king of your life, and what would that look like? So now we are on egg number 8, or the 8th and 9th items in your egg. And after all this torture had happened to Jesus, and the soldiers in the crowd had mocked him, Jesus was led to be crucified. They made Jesus, beaten and bruised, carry his heavy wooden cross up a hill to a place called Golgotha. And when they got there, Jesus was nailed to the cross alongside two other criminals. On the sign above Jesus' head was written, "This is Jesus, King of the Jews." All this happened about 12 o'clock lunchtime, and from then until 3 o'clock, the whole world went dark because the sun did not shine. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you left me?" And then he cried out again, "It is finished." And he died. And when this happened, a Roman centurion was standing in front of Jesus, and he heard his cry and saw how he died. At that moment, the man fell to his knees and said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." And in your egg, you have a small cross bead, something like this, to remind you of Jesus' death on the cross. And you also have a split pin. This pin looks a little bit like a nail, and it can remind you of the nails that were beaten into Jesus' hands and feet to nail him to the cross. If you touch that to your palm, just gently, it's a bit sharp, Not nice. Can you imagine how having nails put through your hand would have felt? Now, once Jesus had died, the soldiers had to check that he was really dead before they took him off the cross. And normally, they would break the legs of the criminals to make sure they died, to speed it up as well, because if their legs were broken, they would definitely die. But they could see that Jesus was already dead, so instead, they got a spear and they stuck it into his side. And out of his side flowed a mixture of blood and water. Now, we're on number 9, and in your egg, you have a piece of red ribbon. It won't be as long as this. And this ribbon acts as a reminder of the blood that Jesus shed on that day. Not only once he was dead, but when he was beaten and nailed to the cross. In Jewish times, before all this happened, if someone had done something wrong, they had to sacrifice an animal. And the blood by the animal was a payment for their sin. And I believe that the blood that Jesus shed that day on the cross was the final payment for our sin, for my sin and for your sin, for all the wrong things that we have done in the past, for all the wrong things we do today, and all the wrong things that we will do in the future, even in many years to come. We no longer have to make a sacrifice to God if we do something wrong, because Jesus has paid that sacrifice for us. So Jesus is dead, but his body couldn't be left on the cross. In Israel, the country where Jesus lived, it's very hot, not like the UK, and bodies would start to smell very quickly. Jesus' body was taken down and taken to a tomb where he was prepared to be buried. He was anointed with spices to hide the smell and wrapped in linen cloth. Because this all happened just before the day of rest, which we call the Sabbath, the women who were preparing Jesus' body had to work quickly. In fact, they ran out of time before they had to stop. And in Jewish law, you had to stop when it was the Sabbath. Now, inside your egg, you have a piece of bandage to remind you of the linen cloth that Jesus was wrapped in when he was dead. And think about how we use bandages today. We use them to wrap up a wound if we hurt ourselves, to care for someone when they are hurt. And you may also want to smell the clothes that are in your egg. Now, we can use clothes today in cooking. They're a spice. But smell the clothes. And I want you to think back to the Christmas story. Yep, the Christmas story. I've not gone mad. I'm not cracked up. Another Easter pun there. But the Christmas story. And do you remember the gifts that were given to baby Jesus at Christmas? Gold, frankincense and myrrh. And frankincense and myrrh are spices and fragrances that would have been used to prepare a body to be buried. Again, we're going back to the perfume that the woman poured all over Jesus right at the start of this story. So why would you give those to a baby? That was a strange thing. And I imagine that Mary, Joseph's mother, probably thought the same thing as well. But this was a sign of what was to come to Jesus and to his death for all of us. So once Jesus's body had been prepared to be buried, it was placed in a tomb. It wouldn't have been buried in a hole like in the ground like we do today, but it would have been placed in a hole dug on the side of a hill. The tomb was then covered by an enormous stone and guarded by Roman soldiers. This shows how worried those guards and Romans were that Jesus' body would be stolen. You wouldn't normally have soldiers guarding a tomb after somebody had died. So they did everything they could to stop anyone from getting in or getting out of that tomb. Now, in your egg, you've got a couple of stones, and these stones are absolutely tiny. But it's just to remind you of that stone. But have you ever tried to lift a really heavy stone? It's so difficult. This stone would have been impossible to have been moved, especially by one person, especially if there were guards standing right in front of it. Now, can you imagine you are lifting a really heavy stone? Can you do it? Oh, I don't know, I can. or you might want to try pushing against a wall with all your might, and how that is how impossible it would have been to move that stone. So the day after the Sabbath day, it would have been a Sunday to us, Mary and Martha, the women who were getting Jesus' body ready, went to finish getting his body ready for burial. They got to the tomb and they found that the stone had been moved away. They went inside and found the tomb empty. Well, except for an angel and folded grave clothes, so the folded things that they had wrapped Jesus in. They'd been folded up nice and neatly. "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" asked the angel. "He is not here. He has risen." And the women were understandably very upset and very confused. They thought that somebody had stolen Jesus' body. And Mary stood outside the tomb and she was so sad. She was crying. And this man came up to Mary and said, a man who she thought was the gardener, and said, "Woman, why are you crying?" And Mary said, "Where have you put him?" Got that wrong. So the day after the Sabbath day, which would have been a Sunday to us, Mary and Martha went to finish getting Jesus' body ready for burial. They got to the tomb to find that the stone had been moved away. They went inside and found the tomb empty. Well, empty except for an angel and folded grave clothes. They had been folded up. And the angel said, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He's not here. He has risen." The women were so sad. They were confused. They were upset. They thought somebody had stolen Jesus' body. And then Mary was sat outside the tomb crying. I imagine she was so upset. When she saw the man who she thought was the gardener. "Where have you put him?" Mary said to the man. "Mary" was all the man had to say for Mary to realise that this man was Jesus. He had risen from the dead. Death could not hold him down. So I've got one more egg left. And you might think, "Michelle, what's going on? I must have lost something because my egg is empty." But so is mine. And this empty egg is to remind us of that empty tomb and that Jesus is risen, that death could not hold him down. And this is often why Easter eggs are hollow in the middle, to remind us of Jesus's resurrection. However, this empty egg and empty tomb does not mean that our life is empty. Like the memory verse that Andrew and Hope and Ruby and Anna discovered for us earlier in that Easter egg hunt, we learn in John 10:10 where Jesus said, "I came to give you life and life to the full." The empty tomb gives us the promise of full life, a full and rich life. Jesus died to give you full life with him and God forever in eternity if you ask him to be your friend. When Jesus left to go back to heaven, he told his disciples, "I am with you always, even to the very end of the age." And that can be true for each of us too. When we choose to say yes to Jesus and accept and trust in him for what he did for us, because he loves us so much. I hope that you really enjoyed that story and finding out about the reason that we celebrate Easter. Now, Chloe and Caleb are going to lead us in a prayer thanking Jesus for Easter and for what he did for us at Easter time. And after that, we're going to have another song. You can wave your palm branches, you can sing along if you know the words, or you can just dance along and enjoy it. And thanks to Matt for leading us in this song.
Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son to die for us. We are so thankful that you love us so much that Jesus died on the cross for our sake. Knowing that we are forgiven is a great gift. We are so grateful for your sacrifice.
We also remember that you rose again on Easter Sunday. Thank you for the hope that gives us that no matter how bad things seem, you can always do amazing things. We are glad that death is not the end and thankful for the comfort this brings. Amen.
breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all things, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, Jesus, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me. Oh, all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Now, I believe in this story. This story gives me life, and I pray that it gives you life too. I believe that this story is true and that Jesus did all of this. He was welcomed as a king, arrested, beaten, died, and took all this pain for each one of us in 1 week. Jesus died in order to take all of the pain and suffering that we could ever feel and make a way that we can be friends with God. However, Jesus' death isn't the end though. The end isn't here yet. Jesus' resurrection is why we celebrate Easter. Jesus rising from the dead means that we can look forward to the promise of everlasting life with God forever if we say sorry for all the things that we have done and ask him to live in our hearts and be our special friend forever. Now, if you believe this too and you would like Jesus to be your special friend, I'm going to say a prayer that you can repeat after me. I will say it, pause, and then go on to the next line. And if you've said this prayer, it would be so good if you could get in touch with us and let us know that you've said this prayer, or tell somebody at home, maybe your mum or dad, your carers, and they could get in touch with us and we can support you with that. And it'd be so great. So if you want to say this prayer with us, feel free. If you don't, you can just sit and enjoy the quiet time. Dear Jesus, thank you that you came to this earth. Thank you that you came because you love me. Jesus, thank you for your death on the cross. And for making a way for me to be friends with God. I am sorry for all the bad things that I have done. And I ask you today to come and live in my heart forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Now please do get in touch if you said that prayer, especially if you said that prayer for the first time today. We would love to support you and pray with you through that. Now I want to say thank you very much for watching, and I hope that you've really enjoyed our egg-cellent story and how we have explored the story of Easter. I hope it hasn't fried and scrambled your brain too much, and I really pray that you will have a really excellent Easter. Now take care and have a lovely Easter, and remember the reason why we celebrate. Bye!